Been 11, 12 segments in Joshua. Over the cast we have spanned, of course, Valentine's Day and Easter. We have seen Joshua be victorious by staying faithful. And we have seen Joshua fall by not staying faithful. We have seen the structure that God has set for us to be victorious, and how he has given us structures in our life that we are to stay within. And we saw what happened to Joshua when he left those structures as well. Joshua's story is what's inspired the vision of this year. And it's only fitting that we finish our series on Joshua with Joshua chapter 24. This is Joshua's farewell to his people. His life has pretty much ran its course, and soon he will be in glory. With the speech that Joshua gave, I have chosen 3 points for the case for obeying and loving God. Joshua points these out as well to his people. So you could turn to Joshua 24. And we're going with our first point, which is God's goodness. Goodness. Joshua gathers all the people around. And the first thing that he wants to tell them or wants them to remember is the goodness of God. The journey that spanned his lifespan. Joshua starts with the goodness of God. He wants them to remember. And the reason he wants them to remember the goodness of God is that he wants them to stay humble. Because that's key to a Christian life. It's key to a Christian life today. Staying humble and remembering that there is a Lord that is over you. There is someone full of power, knowledge, wisdom, who is your master, who has given you instructions of the structures of different areas of your life in Scripture. And remember that you belong to him.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Starting at verse 12, Joshua says this. We're reading this from Joshua. He's reminding them of what God had promised them. And he says, I sent the hornet ahead of you, and it drove out the two Ammonite kings before you. It was not by your sword or by your bow. Remember, the victories that you receive today are not because of what you do, it's because of what he does.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
If we see victories in the vision coming in 2016, it's not because of us, it's because of God.
Amen.
We get the privilege of saying yes to a master and also seeing his power at work. And that is an awesome privilege. So Joshua was telling them. And what he's telling him is he's telling him that God delivers on his promises. This promise was in Exodus chapter 23, verse 28. And it says, I will send the hornet in front of you, and it will drive out the Hivites, the Canaanites, the Hittites away from you. Joshua was reminding them that God delivers on the promises that he gives you. Because of his goodness, because of who he is, he delivers, keeps his word. And it's with you. Look at verse 13. Again, he's pounding home this same ideal. I gave you a land you did not labor for, and cities you did not build. Though you live in them, you are eating from vineyards and olive groves that you did not plant. If you go back to Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 10 and 11, you'll see where this promise was made by God. When the Lord your God brings you into a land he swore to you, to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that he would give you a land with large and beautiful cities that you did not build, houses full of every good thing that you did not fill them with, wells dug that you did not dig, and vineyards and olive groves that you did not plant. And when you eat and are satisfied, look at verse 12. Just 10 to 11, I'm sorry. So he's reminding them once again, he's staying on this series of thought. Remember, God had already promised you these things before you ever entered into the promised land. He said, those cities that are built so beautiful that you're dwelling in, never take it for granted. It's a blessing that God gave you. You didn't build them, but God gave them to you. He says, the land that you're walking on, never take it for granted. That's a blessing I give you. You did not labor for that land. He says, the vineyards and the olive groves that you're eating from that are satisfying your stomach so that you're not hungry, it's another blessing that I gave you. You did not plant them. They were given to you by the awesome power and grace and love of God, your master. Because you were willing to be obedient, God delivered on the promises that he said that he would do. And it's the same with life today. We need to understand that God is still the God today that he was in those days. He still delivers on the promises that he gives you. If you're willing to stay within the structure that he has for you as a Christian, if you're willing to obey God's commands and follow him, he has blessings for you. I have folks that come in that so many things are going on in their life. It's being hit from every direction, and all things are going, and they're just not clear in their prayer life of what to do, and those things are getting turned upside down, and they ask me what to do, and I tell them, I said, what you need to do is you need to look for the mileposts. You need to go back in life as far back as necessary until you find a milepost in life when you knew God had his hand on you. When you knew that there was a blessing in store for you, when you were confident that you were within the structure frame of God's love. And then I need you to trace from that milepost all the way to where you're at now, following the circumstances of your life. The things that have happened, that some people chalk them up to coincidences, some people chalk them up to luck. I chalk them up to God's wisdom. And you follow those things up to this moment in time, and what's going to happen is you're going to get your clarity back. You're going to understand that you're serving a God. You're going to understand the direction that he wants you to go because you are following what God had you to do. Remember what it's like to receive the blessings that God has given you in the past. Remember the love and the power that you're feeling at that moment in time, because God has promised you that continuously. And again, Joshua reminds them that God delivered the promises that was given to them, just like God delivers on the promises that's given to us. And Joshua reminds them that it's not what you have done, but it is what God has done for you. And if we can remember those things, we can stay humble. If we can remember that we have a master who makes the decisions for us and we just simply do obey, we can stay humble. If we can remember when those decisions in life come up and we need to make that choice to go to God our master for the wisdom to make those choices, we can stay humble. Because I'm telling you now, that service is a sacrifice. And the only way that you're going to sacrifice in life today is if you remember that you are serving a master. Because human nature says, do what's best for us. We'll make the choices that are best for us. But God's nature says, we'll make the choices that's best for him. And we will sacrifice what's best for us to do what's best for him. Brings us to our second point. God demands service. If you're going to say that you belong to God, he's going to demand service. Look at verse 14. Therefore, fear the Lord with worship, and fear the Lord and worship him in sincerity and truth. Get rid of the gods your father worshipped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt, and worship Yahweh. 1 John 3:18 says, "The little children, we must not love with word or speech, but with truth and action." In other words, you can't use your lips and say that you belong to God and that you're a Christian and not show it with the actions that you take in daily life. Because your walk is proven by the decisions that you're making, not by the claims that you're voicing. To serve God, listen to me now, to serve God is a call to action. You can't say that you're serving God and not be active in a ministry for God. You can't say that you're serving God and not be active in studying His Word. You can't say that you're serving God and not have an active prayer life. You can't say that you're serving God and not actively promoting the good news of Jesus Christ. I hear it all the time in 30 years of ministry. I love this church. I hear them say, "I love this church." They'll come up to me, "I just love this church." And they'll walk away and they'll do nothing else in it or for it. They won't support it with their abilities. They won't support it with their finances. They won't support it with their gifts, but yet they love this church. Your actions speak louder than your words. If you're going to talk the talk, then God is going to expect you to walk the walk. And to walk the walk means that you're going to serve God. And to serve God means you're willing to sacrifice and die to self of what you want for what God wants. To serve God, Titus 2:7 says, "In everything make yourself an example of good works with..." Now, underline this if you're underlining this in Scripture, because this one tripped me up years ago. It made me stumble for a little bit. But I learned a perfect lesson on this, and again, I'll read it. "In everything make yourself an example of good works with integrity and dignity in your teaching." Listen to what Deuteronomy chapter 10, verses 12 through 14 says. "And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God ask of your, except to fear the Lord your God by walking in all His ways, to love Him and to worship Him, the Lord your God, with all your heart and all your soul. Keep the Lord's commands and statutes I am giving you today for your own good. The heavens indeed, the highest heavens, belong to the Lord your God, as does the earth and everything in it." One of the things Christians do, now pay close attention because I'm going to get into how I stumble. One of the things that Christians do, according to Paul, is that we are to be ambassadors for Christ. What does it mean to be an ambassador? Well, if you look at the political realm of today, to be an ambassador means that you go to a foreign country and you represent the morals, the behavior, and the ideology of your country. We belong to Jesus Christ. So that means we need to represent to those who don't belong to Jesus Christ the morals and ideals and the actions of Jesus. Here's where I stumble to a point. Years ago, at least 20 years ago, God had come up with an idea for me to start a children's program. A children's program with Bubbles the Clown years ago, which had been Shasta at the time. But to actually start a program to actually write skits with puppets involved and to air it on local television and to do it all throughout the different churches of teaching children, a children's show teaching children about morals that God would want us to do. And it really took fire, and we had four folks jump on board. And we're meeting, and everything was going well. We were brainstorming scripts. Matter of fact, I still have them. We were brainstorming scripts for this. We were talking, necessary. We ran into a wall about distributing. And then someone in the group wanted to bring this group on board, this project, that had the ability, the vehicle, to run this out, to make it as best as possible. But the problem is, they were saying they were Christian, but they weren't acting like Christians. So what happened was, in my brain, it's going with all the excuses, well, this project's going to be so great, it's going to reach children for Jesus, you can overlook that their behavior is not up to par with yours. It's going to touch so many kids, it was going to touch their families, and look at all the blessings. Yeah, that's true. So forget about that. And it went on a little while, and it just continued to deteriorate. Let me tell you something about integrity. If you're not on board, eye level, with somebody that you're spending time with on integrity, you're not going to increase theirs. They're going to drop yours. Okay. Now, you may say that I can bring theirs up, but I'm telling you what's going to happen. They're going to drop your integrity. So it got to the point where I said, enough, I can't do this anymore. The ends does not justify the means. Because I cannot associate myself with this certain person. Because this person says one thing and then they go out in the world and they do something else. And when they do something else, people see what they do and then they turn around and go, that's the fella that Pastor Carr associates with.
Amen.
And all of a sudden, the standard of my integrity, even though I'm living an integrity life, drops because I'm associated with someone that gives lip service but not service. And I cannot have my integrity dropped by somebody else. Because I hold myself at a high standard, I can't have mine attached to somebody else that don't. So no matter how great this project was, no matter how great things were going, I left the project. And that was a sacrifice on my part because every fiber of my body wanted to do this project. But I learned something. Do all good works with integrity and dignity. If you are pairing yourself with someone who mouths that they're a Christian, but they're not a Christian, if they've got a bad reputation, you need to investigate that reputation. If it's true, and your integrity is above that, you need to part ways from that person. Because you're not going to increase their integrity. They're going to drop yours. Because no matter what you do in your life, if they do something different, they're always going to say, well, you know, so-and-so hangs out with so-and-so. That's why when you do a ministry, the integrity level should be at least on the level of where you're at. Because you can both support each other. Because I've been doing this for 30 years, and I know for a fact it is very rare. It's about like the reason that God wants a believer to marry to a believer and not an unbeliever, because in 30 years I've seen it work the opposite way once or twice where they bring them to Jesus, and all the rest of the time their walk suffers. So that's what I've learned, and that's what Joshua is telling them here. If you're going to talk the talk, you've got to walk the walk. What do I want out of you? Here's what I want out of you. I want your walk to be the best that it can be. I want you to fear the Lord your God, and I want you to strive for perfection. Because I want you to be an example for Jesus Christ.
Amen.
An ambassador. Joshua 24:19-23. But Joshua told the people, you will not be able to worship Yahweh because he is a holy God. He is a jealous God, and he will not remove your transgressions and sins. If you abandon the Lord and worship foreign gods, he will turn against you, harm you, and completely destroy you after he has been good to you. And that's, I've got marked above in my notes, 2x4 there. Because here's the other section. We talked about one section. The other section of the second point is this. If you call yourself a Christian, serving a God, but yet you're serving self instead of serving God. If you have pride in your heart instead of serving God, you're no longer serving God, you're serving pride. You're serving another God. If you have a root of bitterness in your heart that is choking out your walk, and you choose not to get rid of that root of bitterness, you're not serving God anymore, you're serving that root of bitterness. Because my God and your God is a jealous God, and there's only room for one person in his heart, in your heart, and that's him. If it's jealousy, strife, envy, any of these things, you are literally choosing not to serve God. And you say, well, that's a little difficult. You know, things are complicated. Things are complicated because humans get in the way and make them complicated. It is not complicated to give up a root of bitterness. You do that by giving it to God and allowing his power and blood to wash through you. And trust me, I had to learn that avenue. I've been done wrong so many times, but you know, you just say it's under the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's another battle scar. If it's because you're used to calling your own shots because you can't deny self, well, guess what? You're serving self. You're not serving the God that you say that you're serving. And here's what's going to happen. Your walk is going to suffer. 2x4 therapy. It says if you abandon your Lord and worship foreign gods, and that's the sin, he will turn against you, harm you, and completely destroy you after he has been good to you. Why? Because it's better for him to do these things and you to return to the fold than to leave you out there. So if you're serving any other god of sin in your heart right now instead of God, if you're not willing to sacrifice to serve, then you're not serving God. And if you're not serving God, get ready for your walk to suffer. Get ready for 2x4 therapy to kick in. Get ready to start not seeing clearly what God has for you in life, because this is the things that are going to happen. He is a loving God, but he is a jealous God.
Amen, amen.
And he gives us a structure in this Word of God that we're supposed to stay within. And the moment we choose not to stay within the structure is the moment that his jealousy kicks in. You will not serve two gods when you serve the God of Israel. You will not have it. So Joshua is telling them this. Get rid of all the little foreign gods. Joshua warns the Israelites, serving God will be difficult. And it will. Because the reason it's difficult is the self-sacrifice that you've got to make. That's why it makes it so difficult for us. We've got to learn to die to self. We've got to learn to die from the ego. We've got to learn to die from pride. We've got to learn to die from all these things to serve our Master God who lives in heaven. And that's why it's difficult. And Joshua says, that's why it's difficult. But listen to what he says. Don't choose lightly. If you choose to serve God, then live your life right. Sacrifice comes with service. Matthew 12:30 says, anyone who is not with me is against me, and anyone who does not gather with me scatters. Luke 16:13 says, no household slave can be the slave of two masters, since either he will hate one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You can't be slaves to both God and money. And I could have went three or four more verses, but I think you get the point. Joshua continues to tell them, it is a sacrifice not to take lightly. Service depends on the sacrifice. Listen, if you're not sacrificing daily to serve God, then you're really not serving God. If you're not sacrificing that precious time in a 24-hour period to get study time in, to get quiet time in, to get prayer time in, if you're not sacrificing to do things for ministries, if you're not doing these things because you're just too busy, well, then you're serving the God that you choose. Let me recap the first 2 points before we get to the third. It's a farewell speech Joshua's telling his people. First is, remember the goodness of God in your life. When you come on those hard times, those troubled times, the things that you don't know of, the decisions that you've got to make, remember the good things. Remember the promises that God has always delivered for you. Remember that he supplies all your needs according to his riches and glory. Remember that he promised that he would be with you from the rest of the time to the ends of the earth. Remember the time that you didn't know what to do, and the next thing you know, all of a sudden God delivers something for you, pulls up, snatches a victory from the jaws of defeat. The times when finances were so tough, but yet you were faithful, and all of a sudden the check showed up. I've told this story before, but I'm going to repeat it. There was a time when a young lady at our church in Allentown got saved. Through counseling, she got saved. Her husband wasn't saved. And they were struggling paycheck to paycheck. Pretty much everybody knows the idea. And she tithed 1 week. And when she did, she took it out of the food budget, and all of a sudden the last day there was no food for dinner. And he goes, well, now let's see your God provide now. Well, at that time, Lauren and I were living paycheck to paycheck, and we treated ourselves once a week. We got a pizza and we played games. That's what we did. As we were driving home, Lorna says, I know God's telling me we need to give this pizza away. Now all I can smell is the pepperoni. Are you sure? Because I really don't think that's to be the case. He said, yeah, we got bologna at home, but we need to give this pizza away. So I said, okay, fine, stop. Took our pizza that we waited on. We get pizza twice a month for the paycheck. Knocked on the door. Opened the door and there's her husband. I give him the pizza and I said, special delivery from God. I hope you enjoy it. And he got this big look on his face and puzzled look on his face, and I left. Well, that Sunday, she told us the story. He was yelling at her, let your God feed us. If there is a God that you're serving, let's see your God feed us now. And that's when I knocked on the door and said, special delivery from God. On pepperoni pizza. 2 weeks later, he became a Christian.
Amen.
God has perfect time. But there's always sacrifice. That sacrifice of eating that bologna sandwich at night is a blessing to this day. It is. It's a blessing to this day to give away that hot pizza. So remember the good things that God does, delivers for you. And the second thing was, is if you're going to serve Him, make a choice to serve Him, here's what you're going to need to do. You're going to need to serve Him. And that means you're going to need to sacrifice to serve. And that means things that you really, truly want to do, maybe even working for the Lord, like my little story there, working for the Lord, and you can see the end results, but yet the integrity was there. It means you need to get up and you need to walk away from it. When every fiber of your body wants to do it, you got to walk away from it because you got to sacrifice. Why? Because you need to keep your integrity intact. Why? Because you're going to need that integrity to serve God at a later date. We strive to be the best that we possibly can be to serve our Lord. And then make sure that if you choose to serve God, that you serve Him with all of your heart. You see, your life is not yours anymore. It belongs to the Lord to do with as He pleases. And that brings us to our third point. Make a choice. Joshua made a choice. Look at verse 15. But if it doesn't please you to worship Yahweh, choose for yourselves today whom you will worship. The gods your father worshiped beyond the Euphrates River, or the gods of the Amorites whose land you are now living in. For as me and my family, we will worship Yahweh. As I've grown to remember it, for as me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Amen.
So today is the day you choose, folks. Today is the day you choose. I'm going to do something right now. Bow your head with me and close your eyes. Joshua was telling these folks, his people, what it took to serve God. So I want you to look in your heart today. And I want you to make a choice today. Don't make that choice lightly, but make a choice to where you stand. 1 Kings 18:21 says, then Elijah approached all the people and said, how long will you hesitate between two opinions? If Yahweh is God, follow Him. But if Baal is, follow him. But the people didn't answer Him a word. No answer is an answer. No decision is a decision. You can't play a Christian today. And here's the challenge. With everything that you heard in these 3 points, choose this day who you serve. If it's God, then serve Him. Sacrifice to serve. Die to self to serve. Get rid of the other gods that are leading your heart and serve. Make the time in your life daily and serve. Amen. If you believe in this vision that we're going to do, serve. Pick a spot and serve. If you believe in this ministry here at Shining Light Baptist Church, then choose to serve. Choose to serve with your time. Choose to serve with your talent. Choose to serve with your finances. But above all, choose this day whom you serve. Giving you just a second. And I'll leave you with these two questions. Which is it? It's not a tough choice. You just need to make it. God says, I'd rather you be hot or cold instead of lukewarm, because lukewarm's not good. I'll spew you out of my mouth. Sitting on the fence is not good enough. Saying that you love God and His church is not good enough. Your actions is what proves these things. Or, if that's too much for you, then be truthful to yourself and say, I can't do it. Are you willing and are you ready to sacrifice and die to self? If there's a root of bitterness, are you willing to sacrifice self, ego, and all the above things, the bitterness, the hurt, and all these things? Are you willing to give them up, put them under the blood so that you can have a heart that only fits God to serve God? Are you piling around with the right folks? Are you starting ministries? Are you doing ministries? Or are you in your family, friends that you're at work? Are you devoted to people of integrity? Are you devoted to make sure the group that you're with has the integrity that will not destroy yours? If not, then it may be time to cut, to sever the ties. Or keep them, your choice. But realize this. You're realizing this is that it is sinful. And let's just call it what it is. You're choosing to live outside the structure that God has for you. All right, with every head bowed and your eyes still closed, let me ask you today, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, but you know He's knocking on your door, your heart's door, all you have to do is say this prayer. You don't have to say it out loud, but you do have to mean, Lord, forgive me of my sins. I'm lost, and I need You in my life. Replace my will with Yours, and I will follow You for an eternity. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you said that prayer via our video or our CD ministry, congratulations on the decision that you made today. Welcome to the family of God. We'd love you to come here to Shine Light Baptist Church, 294 Mount Vernon Avenue, Marion, Ohio, 43302, and tell us of that decision so that we can help you grow as a Christian. Maybe you have a home church. Maybe you have a church that you like to go to. Then I encourage you to go to that church and tell that pastor the decision so they can help you along the way. If you're here today and you made that prayer, just raise your head and look up at me. I'm going to ask you 3 questions. Maybe you're here today and you're a believer in Jesus Christ. Who'd you choose to serve today? Who'd you choose that your house would follow today? And if it is God, then get rid of all the idols that are in your heart that stumbles your walk. Get rid of the pride. Get rid of the root of bitterness. Get rid of the jealousy. Get rid of the hurt. Get rid of the pain. And give it to God, because you belong to Him. You need to serve Him. You need to serve in the ministry. Maybe you chose the other direction. This altar is open for you as well. We have prayer warriors to pray with you, counselors standing by to help you. But whatever it is, we are dedicated to make your walk better as a Christian that you leave these doors than when you come in. We start by giving you the truth. All right, let me raise your hands.